Okay, this is 2015 pure chemistry, class test 5 on chemical calculation, acid, bases and salt. First question, 500 cm cube, 0.5 mole per dm cube of this particular compound. So from the calculation here, from the volume and the concentration, you should be able to find out the number of mole of the compound. So the number of mole is 0.25. Now every 1 mole of this compound, there should be 2 mole of ammonium ion, so that means you have to split it, 1 mole of copper 2 ion and 2 mole of sulfate ion. So for every 1 mole of this compound, you should have 2, 3, 4, 5, 5 mole of the ion. So now you have, you don't have 1 mole, you have 0.25 mole. So you have 0.25 mole, that means you would have 5 over 4, which is 1.25. 1.25 mole of the ions. Okay, this one is 0 divided by 4, so this one must be divided by 4 as well. That's why 5 over 4, 1.25 mole of ion. So the answer is D for the first question. Okay, for the second question, 1.97 gram of an unknown metal carbonate MCO3. Now MCO3, from here you can split it, you can find out that your M, the charge is 2 plus because carbonate is CO3 2 minus, so the M should be 2 plus. Reacts completely with 50 cm cube, 0.4 mole per dm cube. Again from 50 cm cube, 0.4 mole per dm cube, you can multiply these two numbers and then you can get the number of mole of hydrochloric acid. So the number of mole of hydrochloric acid should be 0.02 mole. Okay, what is the relative atomic mass of M? So first of all, write down the chemical formula, the chemical equation, MCO3 plus HCl. This is a carbonate, this is an acid, so you would get a salt, and the salt is MCl2. Why is it MCl2? Because M is 2 plus, Cl is minus, so MCl2 plus CO2 plus H2O. And of course you have to balance it, put a 2 here. Is it balanced? Yes, it is balanced. So from the chemical equation here, you can find out that the mole ratio for MCO3 and HCl is 1 mole to 2 mole. Now you have how many mole of MCO3? You have 0.02 mole. Oops, sorry. You have 0.02 mole, 0.02 mole of HCl. Okay, 0.02 mole of HCl. So this MCO3 should be 0.01 mole. Okay, it means that 0.01 mole of MCO3 is 1.7 gram. Okay, 0.01 mole, 1.7 gram. So can you find out the MR? So from the triangle, mass, mole, MR. So MR is mass divided by mole, and then the mass is 1.97, mole is 0.01, and that would give 197. Okay, so the MR for this MCO3 is 197. So how do you find the AR for M? So from here, MR of MCO3 is 197. MR of MCO3 is the AR of M plus AR for carbon, which is 12, and for oxygen, which is 16 times 3, which is 48. 197. So M plus 60, 197. So M is 197 minus 60, which is 137. So the relative atomic mass for M is 137. So the answer is C. Okay. Now, for number 3, which of the following compounds contains the greatest mass of oxygen in 10 grams of the sample? So basically, this question, you have to find out the percentage composition of oxygen in each of these compounds. So for example, magnesium, what is the percentage composition of oxygen? How many oxygens are there? There are 6, so 6 times 16, divided by the MR of the entire thing. Of the entire thing would be Mg, 24, plus 2 nitrogen, 14 times 2, plus 6 times 16. Okay, find out. So for each one of them, you have to find out the percentage composition of oxygen, and the answer should be A, greatest mass. So for magnesium nitrate, it has the greatest percentage composition of oxygen. For number 4, when 0.05 mole of oxygen gas Sorry, I have to increase the speed of the fan. Okay, 0.05 mole of oxygen gas reacts with 0.05 mole of hydrogen gas. Steam is formed. So you have oxygen, you have hydrogen, and then you have steam. So balance it, 2, 2. Okay, what would be the remaining volume of gases measured at room temperature and pressure? You have 0.05 mole. Now, if you look at the mole ratio, 1 is to 2. If you have 0.05 mole of oxygen, you would need 0.1 mole of hydrogen to react. But I only have 0.05, which means that hydrogen is limiting. Hydrogen is limiting means that all these 0.05 mole of hydrogen would be used up. So if I have 0.05 mole of hydrogen here, I would need only half of this, which is 0.025 mole of oxygen to react. So out of this 0.05 mole of oxygen, only 0.025 mole of oxygen will react, which means that 0.025 mole of oxygen remain. Okay, so you have 0.025 mole of oxygen, react with 0.05 mole of hydrogen, you would get 0.05 mole of steam at the end of the experiment. So at the end of the experiment, you have 0.05 mole of steam and 0.025 mole of oxygen remaining, which give it a total of 0.075 mole of gases. Steamer is a gas. So at the end of it, at the end of the experiment, you have 0.075 mole of gases remaining. And what would be the volume? The volume would be this number of mole times 24. And that would give you 1.8 dm cubed. Okay? And number 5 is a giveaway. Aluminium saucepan oxidized on the surface to aluminium oxide. Why can this oxidized layer be removed by both acids and alkalis? So basically what it means is that why aluminium oxide can react with both acid and alkali? So because it is an amphoteric oxide. Amphoteric oxide, remember, it can react with both acid and base. So number 5, the answer is B. Let's look at number 6 here. Number 6, you have aqueous ammonia, NH3AQ. Warm, you get gas X. So this gas X, which turn moist red litmus paper blue, this one must be ammonia. NH3, ammonia gas. Then you have ammonia and hydrochloric acid, aqueous ammonia. Remember, aqueous ammonia is the same as NH3AQ or NH4OH. They are the same. All these three are the same. Okay, at dilute hydrochloric acid. So NH4OH AQ plus HCl AQ. This is alkali, this is acid, so it will give you salt and water. Salt would be ammonium chloride, which is AQ, and then plus H2O, which is liquid. So your colorless solution of salt A is ammonium chloride. Then over here I have aqueous ammonia, add a green solution B and filter. What would be the green solution? And then you get, after you add the green solution, there is a precipitate. So the precipitate is green color. So it's a green precipitate. So the precipitate must be something hydroxide, which is insoluble, which is green. So the only possibility is iron 2 hydroxide. So this one is iron 2 hydroxide, which means that this one must be iron 2. This one must be iron 2 something, but iron 2 what, we don't know. Then you add this ready, that you get the, then after that you get the filtrate. Then you add dilute nitric acid, silver nitrate. This is a test for chloride. So this white PPT here must be silver chloride, which means that the chloride, the silver come from here. So the chloride must have come from the filtrate. The chloride must have come from the green solution, because there is no chloride here. So this one must be iron 2 chloride. So your B is iron 2 chloride. Your C is iron 2 hydroxide. Your D is silver chloride. And your A is sodium hydroxide. Ammonium chloride. Okay, ammonium chloride, iron 2 chloride, iron 2 hydroxide, and silver chloride. Okay, so that will take care of ABCD for part A. Suggest why the moist red litmus paper is used to test for gas X rather than a dry one. So your answer must be able to tell me that what happened to the water, because it's a moist water. So what happened, what does the water do to gas X? So you must say gas X dissolve in water, then form what? They cause it to be to turn the red litmus paper to blue, which is a hydroxide ion, which is alkali. The cause of alkali is hydroxide ion, to form hydroxide ion. Okay, dissolve in water to form hydroxide ion, which turns moist red litmus to blue. Okay, the key point here is dissolve in water to form OH minus. The rest you can do away with. Okay, this is the key point. Now write a balanced chemical equation for any one of the reactions. So any one of the reactions, I have these reactions here. Ammonium hydroxide plus HCl. I can also write this reaction. Okay, this reaction, which is your aqueous ammonia, ammonium hydroxide, plus your solution B is iron 2 chloride. And then what do you get? You get iron 2 hydroxide, which is your solid C, iron 2 hydroxide. So iron 2 hydroxide, and then what is left is ammonium chloride. And you can balance it. Yeah, this is one possibility. So this is one possible answer. This is another possible answer. And Yeah. Okay. Now, how about write the ionic equation for the formation of white precipitate D? White precipitate D is your silver chloride. This is your silver chloride. Remember, this is a shortcut. Your silver chloride is a solid. You can actually write like this, the ionic equation. You don't have to write down the entire chemical equation. You can split it. So AgCl consists of Ag plus, it should be Aq plus Cl minus Aq. So this is a shortcut for writing the ionic equation, whereby there is only only one substance is not Aq, like in this case, silver chloride. Okay, in a laboratory practical, a student prepared pure copper 2 sulfate crystal and recorded his procedure as follow. So the first one is to write a balanced equation for the reaction above. Very simple. This is copper 2 oxide and sulfuric acid. Okay, sulfuric acid, Aq. If you don't know how to do this, you know, as usual, I'll say, I don't know what to say. So this is acid base, you get salt and water. Now the procedure above is flawed, it's wrong. So which one is wrong? Definitely the first one. Add excess sulfuric acid. It should be, the insoluble substance should be the excess. Copper 2 oxide should be added in excess to sulfuric acid. Yeah, so your answer should be, so first of all, you have to state that step 1 is flawed. Now, why is it so? Because an excess of sulfuric acid added. So first of all, you have to say, what happened if an excess of sulfuric acid is added? What happened? Okay, that would cause the copper to sulfate form at the end to be contaminated with sulfuric acid. Okay, so the answer should be an excess of sulfuric acid added will result in a solution which not only contains copper to sulfate but also mixed with sulfuric acid. So impure copper to sulfate will be crystallized in the end. Now for C, suggest and explain one way to improve the above experiment. So one way to improve would be to correct step 1. Okay? One way to improve would be to correct the step 1, because part B actually say that, your answer to part B should say that step 1 is wrong. So in order to improve it is to correct the step 1. So you should, your answer should say what you should do instead of the step 1 mentioned here. So for part C, it should be add copper 2 oxide in excess to sulfuric acid and then filter the mixture to remove the unreacted copper 2 oxide. Then after that would be step 2. So your explanation here should be in such a way that right after your explanation, step 2 would take over. Okay? Number 8. The following is a partial outline of one method for the preparation of lead 2 sulfate from lead 2 oxide. Now, first of all, lead 2 sulfate is an insoluble salt. So you should use the precipitation method. And in order to use the precipitation method, the two starting material must be soluble. But lead 2 oxide is not soluble. That is why the question actually give you a hint here. In order to proceed from lead 2 oxide, what should you do? So dissolve lead 2 oxide in hot dilute nitric acid. So if you react these two, this is a base, this is acid base, you should get salt and water. So when these two are added together, you should get something called lead 2 nitrate. And lead 2 nitrate is soluble. That is why after that you add a slight excess of a solution of sodium sulfate. See, sodium sulfate, lead 2 nitrate, both are soluble. which should be the way in order to perform the precipitation method. Okay, part A. Why is there very little reaction if an attempt is made to prepare lead to sulfate by adding lead to oxide to sulfuric acid? So again, this is base, this is acid. So if you do like this, what will happen? You should get base, acid, acid base, salt, and water. So you should get PbSO4, which is insoluble, plus H2O. So this is insoluble. So if you have a beaker, inside you put some, all this solid is PbO, and then you put, you pour acid, H2SO4. Now what happened is, straight away PbSO4 will form. PbSO4 is insoluble, so you have a layer of PbSO4 form on the surface of PbO, which prevent the PbO from further reaction with the sulfuric acid. So this PbSO4 actually acts as a protective layer to lead to oxide. So you should say that, first of all, lead to sulfate is insoluble. So first of all, your explanation should start with this. Lead to sulfate is insoluble. Insoluble, so what? So it will form a protective layer around PbO. Form a protective layer around PbO, so what? Thus preventing further reaction between PbO and H2SO4. That's it. So the key words are insoluble, protective layer. With protective layer, it will prevent further reaction. These are the keywords in order to get this one mark, which is not easy. But this is very straightforward. I explained it in the class before. So no excuse. Absolutely no excuse. Now for 8B, state the subsequent steps of the experiment to obtain lead to sulfate crystal. Hello, this is just pure memory work. This is straight out from the mind map. This is from here. I only look for these three steps. Okay, the question say to obtain lead to sulfate crystal. So that's all. These are the three steps. And a lot of you, I don't understand why, a lot of you say that you have to heat the solution to saturation. There is no PbSO4 solution form in precipitation method. In precipitation method, straight away after you add the two starting materials together, straight away the salt will form. So in this case, straight away PbSO4 will form. So it's not like the previous, the first two methods whereby a solution of the salt is formed. Then after that, you have to heat the solution to saturation. For this one, no. Okay, so three steps, 2 marks. Okay, the last question. Explain the difference between a strong acid and a weak acid. Again, this is straight out from the mind map. Strong acid and weak acid. So your answer should be strong acid ionizes fully to form H plus ions. Weak acid ionizes partially to form lesser H plus ion. Now lesser, I didn't really look for that word, but you should include that in your explanation. Okay, strong acid ionizes fully to form, you should say, to form a higher concentration of H plus ion. Even though in this marking scheme, I didn't look for that that word. And for weak acid, you should say it ionizes partially to form lesser or lower concentration of H plus ion. Name the weak acid from the table above and give a reason for your choice. So the name acid would be tartaric acid. Why? Because the pH is low. The pH is higher. Very easy. Or you can also say because the reaction with magnesium is slower compared to sulfuric acid. Can also. Or it forms lesser gas bubbles in reacting with magnesium. Equally possible. Now you're given some white wine, a solution of sodium hydroxide, phenolphthalein, and all necessary apparatus. Now, so in this case, I look for phenolphthalein. Okay? I look for phenolphthalein. And I didn't use methyl orange as in the mind map. But you should be able to remember the color change. I mean the color of phenolphthalein in acid and alkali. This one. You should be able to remember colorless in acidic solution, pink in alkaline solution. Didn't I put a tick here? You have to remember these four colors only. So you have to describe fully how you will carry out a titration. Same thing. It is titration. So it is right out from the mind map. It is right here. 3 marks. It is 3 marks because there are quite a number of steps. You must mention the apparatus. You must use pipette. You cannot use measuring cylinder. No one use measuring cylinder for titration. So all this pipette, conical flask, you have to use them. And then instead of methyl orange, use phenolphthalein. Instead of yellow, what would it change to? Phenolphthalein in alkaline solution, it would be pink. And then HNO3, instead of HNO3, that would be the acid. That would be the white wine. That would be white wine. Now you don't say burette the white wine into the flask. I mean, it doesn't sound correct. It should be run the white wine from the burette into the flask. Don't say burette white wine into the flask. And then you have to swirl it until, in this case, would be until the pink color change to colorless. So you have to mention the color change. Very important. So I only look for from here to here. Okay? Because the question say to find the volume of sodium hydroxide required to neutralize a volume of white wine. So only want to find the volume. So all these steps are not necessary. Only this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 steps. 3 marks. Why would it be difficult to use this method for red wine? Because remember the color of phenolphthalein in alkaline solution is pink. So if you use red wine, it would be very difficult to observe the color change. Okay, so your answer is just like that. Color change of phenolphthalein would be difficult to observe. Okay, part C, calculate the concentration in mole per dm cube of tartaric acid in the wine. So you have 25 cm cube of white wine neutralized by 20 cm cube of sodium hydroxide. And this sodium hydroxide, it has concentration. See, you have concentration, you have volume, multiply these two numbers, you get the number of mole of sodium hydroxide, which should be the first thing that you have to find. Number of mole, sodium hydroxide. That would be 20 cm cube, which is 20 divided by 1000 times 0.1. and that would give you 0.002 mole. Then after that, you look at the mole ratio of NaOH and H2T. Oops, sorry. This one should be mole ratio, which is 2 mole to 1 mole from the chemical equation, 2 mole to 1 mole, which in this case, it should be 0.002. So this one would be 0.001. So the number of mole of this tartaric acid would be, so from here, number of mole of H2T is 0.001, and from there, using this number of mole of tartaric acid and the volume, you can find out the concentration. Concentration of H2T, that would be 0.001 divided by 0.025 dm cubed, which is 0.04 mole per dm cubed. It should be 3 sf, but for this marking scheme I didn't look for the 3 sf, so it should be 0.0400 mole per dm cubed. Suggest why the concentration of tartaric acid in the wine may be less than that found by the titration. Why? Because actually, the question already told you. The main acid in red and white wine is tartaric acid, which means that there are other acids present in the tartaric, in the red wine or the white wine. So, the wine may contain other acid. That would be the answer for this. Okay, please redo this test. Try to understand it. If you don't understand, then please feel free to come and look for me. Thank you. Bye-bye.